I'm Duncan Foley, this at the New School for Social Research. The weather's taken a turn for the nicer, so it's more shirt sleeve weather today. This is Advanced Microeconomics 2 of Behavior and Information in Political Economy. What I am planning to do today, we've now gone through four of the prepared lectures. Last week we looked at finished up looking at the social interaction model, the formalism of the social interaction model. And I'd like, as a kind of a footnote almost to that, to do this lecture five, which tries to look at some of the issues that arise when you combine the social interaction model and the entropy-constrained behavior model. And because those two things play a key role together in some of the topics that we're going to do. I think lecture five, unless we get a long discussion of something going, we'll probably only take about half the class time, and then I'll go on to lecture six, which starts to apply these ideas to issues in classical political economy, especially Smith and the early part of Marx's Capital, where he's discussing commodity production. But before I start, let me just see if anybody has a residual question about the Lecture 4 material as you've been looking at it. Okay, well, there's some review in this, certainly a good deal of review in this lecture, so we'll be able to, if there are things that come up that you really want to check out, don't hesitate to ask. This lecture is somewhat a repetition of material that was in lecture two, I think, but it's probably just as well to review it briefly. What happens is that when you have the social interaction model and you look at situations in which the individual's action is actually a probability or a frequency. So you either do something or you don't do something. And the question is, how often do you do it or how often do people not do it? You often see, as we've discovered, best response functions that are step functions, that are these heavy side functions, that there's a certain frequency with which everybody else does the action that's very low and you don't do it, and then there's a tipping point, and above that, everybody does it. It's 100%. And we saw a couple of examples of that kind. For example, the choice of computer system game that we looked at. But we can see that this is exactly parallel to the logic quantal response experiments that we talked about at the very beginning, when we talked about Duncan Luce and Patrick Soupy's and the beginnings of experimental post-war, World War II experimental economics. And it's a natural question, and in fact it turns out to be essential to ask it, because to make these models work and give sensible answers, and you'll see it's actually, there's a very interesting interaction of these two ideas, that we would like to see what happens if the best response is an entropy-constrained best response. So we are not going to allow now a heaviside function, which always puts the equilibrium, the unstable equilibrium, where the 45-degree line crosses the vertical part of the heaviside function. But we're going to look at behavior temperature moderated best response functions. And just to remind you of the quantal response idea, the idea now is we still have Z being what everybody else does. It's the action that everybody else takes. X is the action that the typical individual takes. And we're particularly interested in a situation where X is a best response to itself, so that the so that you have a Nash equilibrium. And then there's still the question of whether that Nash equilibrium is stable or not, because that can make a big difference to what we predict from these kinds of models. There's a expected payoff U, which is X, which is conditional on both what the individual does and what everybody else does. So we want that idea in there. And the conception is that we're going to maximize the expected payoff by choosing frequencies with which the individual performs each of the actions that are available. So the unknowns in this problem are the Fs, the F of X given Z. That's what we're assigning. Those have to be positive, and they have to add up to one or integrate to one over the whole action set. And we're going to multiply those things by the payoff and take the expected payoff. So that's just like von Neumann-Morgenstern. What's different with von Neumann, and if we just had that in these typical examples, you put all the weight on whatever the highest payoff action is. You just, it becomes just this Dirac function, which delta function, where you always do the same thing, namely the single best response. But we're adding the notion that the decision maker is subject to a kind of a information bandwidth constraint, which we represent as a constraint on the entropy. So we don't allow the entropy of this mixed strategy to become too low, put some lower bound on it. In a lot of ways, it doesn't matter a whole lot what that lower bound is exactly, just that it's there, because that leads to a qualitative change in the behavioral outcome. You can see that that leads to the Lagrangian problem, where you do the max min of the Lagrangian function, which is the sum of the expected payoff and the entropy. And this way of, with the Lagrange multiplier capital T, which we call behavior temperature by analogy with similar physical examples. And that is a very nice way to see the fact that now there's a trade-off between payoff and entropy, right? Because you're maximizing a weighted sum of them. So the more you do one, the less you are going to be able to do the other. And you have a real maximization problem. This was part of the problem set that's due today, which I'll talk about a little bit later before the break, is to work out some of these things for specific examples. But there is a general solution which is quite illuminating, namely the Gibbs or logit quantal response distribution. That is, when you differentiate the Lagrangian and set up the first order conditions, because of the logarithmic form of the entropy function, you always get this type of Gibbs distribution, which says that the frequency with which you do any action X given Z is proportional to E to the power, the payoff of that choice, divided by this this behavior temperature T, the Lagrange multiplier T. This is worth getting in your mind, because it comes up over and over again, and if you both understand it well and you can even remember it on the street corner or something, it's going to help. Okay. So you have the social signal Z, and then that leads to a best response. But the best response now is not a single action, X as a function of Z. It's a frequency distribution over all the possible actions. But the frequency distribution gives a higher frequency to higher payoff actions. So the highest payoff actions are the ones that you're going to see more often. That's very important from the point of view of empirical work. because frequently we actually have data on how often different individuals or households or firms do a particular thing or find themselves in a particular situation. And if we can link that up to the Gibbs distribution, then you can get a lot of information about things like the payoffs and relative behavior temperatures from that. It's the take-home message here is that it's only at absolute zero, where t is equal to zero, and you allow the Dirac delta function, which has a zero entropy, that the individual's action is entirely concentrated on the payoff maximizing choice. That means that there's a qualitative change. And that's why it doesn't matter quite so much what H-min is, as long as there's some positive H-min there. No matter how low H-min is, you're going to get a positive T. And once you get a positive T, qualitatively the situation changes, because you don't see the decision maker just doing one thing. You actually see the decision maker do every possible thing with some frequency. And that means if you have an ensemble of similar decision makers, say you have data on a bunch of households or a bunch of firms, then you can interpret their dispersion in terms of this quantal response frequency distribution. Does anybody have any question about that, since we're going to use this set of ideas over and over again now? This is not the last chance to ask a question, but it's a good chance to ask a question. Everybody feels comfortable with that. Okay. So now, if the individuals in the social interaction model are entropy constrained, the best response is going to be a frequency distribution. And that means that the state of the system is going to be described by a frequency distribution. So instead of saying, okay, there's just one level of x, which is the equilibrium level, you're going to say, well, no, we have a frequency distribution over x, and it has the property that when everybody else sees that mean, say the mean of that distribution, the z, they all choose that same distribution if they're operating at the same decision temperature. So there's a generalization of the idea of the Nash equilibrium to quantal response. This idea is quite important in recent game theory. The key papers by McKelvey and Palfrey in 1998, and it's called Quantal Response Equilibria in Nash equilibria, and you can. This is a particular example of that type of thinking, and it's a very powerful extension of the idea of Nash equilibrium, because it doesn't anymore require Nash equilibrium to have this very narrow single-valued character, and it allows you to interpret much more complicated situations, data for much more complicated situations in terms of Nash equilibrium. Jose, see if we can get the microphone. He's over here.
Yeah, my question is, now that you brought up game theory, what's the difference between this sort of equilibria and a mixed strategy Nash equilibrium?
Well, it's an example of a mixed strategy Nash equilibrium. The main difference is that in ordinary Nash equilibrium theory, there's no entropy constraint. So if the mixed, you may have a mixed strategy equilibrium. For example, Nash's original paper, which was his thesis, PhD thesis, I think, proves that there, for any non-cooperative game, there is a Nash equilibrium in mixed strategies. But those mixed strategies are not constrained by any entropy consideration in Nash's way of thinking about it, whereas in the McKelvey-Palfrey thing, they are constrained. And this is still, the social interaction model is still a further specialization of that, because we have this rather special setup where you have a lot of agents who are all identical playing this game against each other, so that you can really look for a best response, a situation where the best response is the best response to itself, and that characterizes the outcome. Okay, so if we're looking for equilibrium in the social interaction model with entropy-constrained behavior, in general it's going to be a frequency distribution over the action set. And here is a Mathematica function that calculates the entropy-constrained frequency distribution given a set of payoffs. The payoff function is called V in this case. There's a minimum and a maximum level of the action, and you integrate the e to the vx over t over that range in order to find the entropy-constrained best response. We've already seen an example that if the payoff function is quadratic, then the unconstrained action distribution, that is one that's not constrained by upper and lower limits, but is only constrained by entropy, the entropy constraint, is a normal probability distribution. So there's an immediate connection here between the Gaussian normal probability distribution and one of the simplest classes of payoff functions that economists often use. But in many social situations, such as, for example, borrowing, if you're thinking about managing assets or money, you almost have to put a lower bound. You can't let the agent go into infinite debt, or you have to put some kind of lower bound or some rising cost to borrowing or something to keep the model well defined. The simplest version of that, there's just a lower bound. For example, the simplest one is you're managing cash and you're not allowed to print your own money, so you can't go below zero. You can have positive cash balances, but you can't have negative cash balances because you're not allowed. This same issue comes up in finance when people deal with short selling, problems of short selling. Short selling, if you don't have any constraint on short selling, that means people can sell any amount of the stock short. But in fact, that's not really institutionally possible. You can never make a contract. For one thing, nobody will accept the contract. You have to put up some kind of collateral. You have to buy the stock first before you sell it, or have some of it, or borrow it from somebody before you can sell it. And that changes the entropy-constrained outcomes. Here, I'll just show you an example with best responses. So this is a response which is quadratic. So it's the typical alpha plus beta z response. And as we change beta, for example, you change the best response level, and you can see that with no constraint on it, you just get a normal distribution around the Quantal response is just a normal distribution like that. we can change the z that it responds to, and that it's trying to match that. If beta, for example, here beta is negative, so the higher is z, the lower is the best response x, because beta is negative, so you have strategic substitutability. If we have strategic complementarity, then the lower is z, the lower is the best response. So you have that. But this all looks like ordinary econometrics because you have a nice normal distribution. But suppose that, and that's because x low, the lower bound, is set to minus infinity. So the agent is allowed to do as negative a thing as any negative or positive value. But if we set the lower bound to zero, then it's still the case that the Loggit Quantal response is the Gibbs distribution. And that means, but it's now truncated. That means it's normal. If the payoff function is quadratic, it's still normal. But it has to be truncated at the lower bound. So if we move this up, for example, suppose z is pretty high, well, it hardly makes any difference, right? Because you still get a nice normal distribution there. But as z goes down now, all of a sudden you get a highly skewed Quantal response because of the zero lower bound. If I take off the zero lower bound, you can see what's going on is that the agent really wants to be down here in negative territory, wants to choose a negative x. But if the agent isn't allowed to choose the negative x, then the agent has a very high probability of very low x's, tries to get down near zero as much as possible, but has this highly skewed one-sided distribution. This kind of thing actually is quite important in economics because these lower bounds are so important. For example, one case that Jiang and Aslam have encountered about this is the case of frontiers. So suppose you're trying to look at efficiency frontiers or profit frontiers. Then by definition, you can't be over a frontier, right? You'd like to be as close to the frontier as you can be, but you can't be beyond it. So you have this kind of constrained situation, and the normal distributions that you often see in econometrics are not going to work. And you can see that it makes a big difference where z is, just what's going on. Does anybody have any question about this? Okay, so we have this basic idea of the Quantal response and the lower bound, which is going to be extremely important when we get to cases where it's the frequency with which you do an action, the Quantal response kind of situation, that is the center of the concern. Now, what does equilibrium in the social interaction model look like when you have the entropy-constrained behavior? And here you want to think this through because it's not so obvious and it requires a little bit of generalization of our usual ideas of Nash equilibrium. The way I've set it up, each typical individual conditions their behavior on this social variable, which we've called z, which I generally call the average or the mean. It doesn't have to be an average or a mean. It could be a median, or it could be some kind of sample of a sample statistic of the behavior of everybody else. But it's simple enough to usually have it be the mean. The best response with entropy constraints is the probability distribution conditioned on z. So an equilibrium is then a value of z such that the behavioral statistic conditioned on z is equal to z. In other words, so it's not now that it's a particular value of x which is a best response to itself. It's a frequency distribution of x that has the property that it is a best response to its own mean, let's say, or whatever the statistic of interest is. And you can compute these things. I just stuck this in because I thought somebody might sometime want to do that. The mean functions for zero lower bound and no lower bound on the quadratic utility are, well, for if there's no lower bound, it's alpha plus z times beta. That's just the regular best response. You can actually, the mean is just the same as it would be without all this elaboration. But if you have the zero lower bound, then you get a quite different mean because of the truncation of the normal distribution. The median functions turn out to be the same. So you don't, because the median is robust, so you cut out some lower chunk of it by the zero lower bound and you don't change the median level. And we can see an interactive plot of this type of equilibrium. In this case, the blue line is the 45 degree line, which is the equilibrium. The green line is the unconstrained best response, and the red line is the constrained best response. So you can see what's going on is that the green, first of all, they coincide when you get up in positive, into the positive area, because then the constraint really doesn't make any difference. But as z gets lower, this is showing a positive, in fact, a beta bigger than 1. As you get z down, then you get a rather dramatic difference in the best response from those two points of view. Let's suppose we go from this highly strategic complementary thing to a much lower one. If you use this interactive, you have to click this update function because this takes a long time to can do the computation, so you can't make it smoothly, you just move around. But here's the case with a smaller smaller degree of strategic complementarity. We can see move A down, and you can see the kind of situation that arises. Well, there it got. In fact, if alpha gets very low, you get really small. The equilibria are still going to be at the intersection, if you can find it, of this 45 degree line and the best responses. But I'm just emphasizing that now the best responses become highly, let me go back to the initial settings here. The best responses have this property that they diverge depending on the why is it going back to the initial settings? There we go. Okay. Depending on the parameters. So you can play around with this if you like, and this is getting closer to a usable model which you could actually try to fit to data. Okay, does anybody have any, want to go over any aspect of this example? No, okay, well. Let's look finally at a little bit more generally some ideas about using entropy-constrained behavior in the social interaction model. And this comes up a lot. It's situations where the typical individual behavior is the frequency with which the individual chooses some quantal action. In those cases, it's possible to replace the quadratic effort term in the payoff function with the behavior temperature weighted entropy directly. So what you're basically saying is the effort here is not the effort of doing whatever it is. The effort is making a decision at all, actually getting into motion and making a decision at all. Let me give you an example so it's a little less abstract. We'll look later in the course at the case of the decision of a typical firm to enter a market, depending on whether the profit rate in that market is higher or lower than the average profit rate. Okay, that would be a typical kind of quantal response. And you can see that that's a kind of representation of the intensity of competition. If the typical firm will enter a market when the profit rate is just a teeny bit above the average, then you expect the distribution of profit rates to be extremely concentrated and extremely narrow. Whereas if the typical firm is more relaxed and has a higher behavior temperature, it's going to allow bigger deviations from the average profit rate before it gets to a high probability of actually entering the market and competing away that difference. So this is the kind of situation that I'm thinking of. Well, here's the way you can set this up. You can say, well, the payoff for the typical individual doing the quantal action with frequency P, when everybody else is doing it with frequency P bar, is what? Well, it's P times the payoff that you do the action, it's 1, given P bar, plus 1 minus P times the probability, the payoff when you don't do the action, and the everybody else is doing P bar. And then we have to add on the entropy of the distribution P and 1 minus P, the Bernoulli distribution P and 1 minus P. And you can work out exactly what that looks like. It's sometimes helpful in this kind of situation to remember that the Taylor expansion of the entropy around P equals 1/2 is in fact a quadratic. So if you look at Jaynes's discussion of this, this is the basis of using the quadratic approximations to measure entropy differences close to, as long as you're kind of in the middle. If you get to extreme values of P, then this quadratic approximation is not very good. You have to have the higher order moments in order to make it work. Okay, let me give you an example to try to make this concrete. And you can. So we're back now to the computer game. But now we're thinking of it not in terms of everybody either choosing Windows or choosing Linux. So we have the same payoff matrix as before. But now the expected payoff to a Windows user depends on the proportion of Windows users there already are. And the according to this arrangement, and the similarly for the Linux users. Now, if we assume that the typical individual computer user operates with an entropy constraint at behavior T, we can actually calculate the best response entropy constrained outcome. But now it's no longer a Heaviside function where you switch over to Windows when the proportion of Windows users becomes high enough. It becomes now a gradual quantal response. In fact, here is the quantal response, and here's a picture of it. for example, when t is equal to, this is the actual payoffs, so the red line here is the 45 degree line. The horizontal axis is p bar, that is the, it's the proportion of Windows users in the population, and here's the mean best response. And if t is very low, the mean best response kind of approximates the Heaviside function. It's really sharply S curve. So you have a rather rapid transition from one operating system to the other. Whereas if the behavior temperature is, say, 10 times that, 1, then you get something like this green line, where you definitely get a response to the strategic complementarity, but it's quite a bit muted by the entropy problem. And this would mean that if you were had data on this, you would try to fit that data to these curves, right? If you had data, for example, where you were able to vary the proportion of the population that was doing one thing or doing the other thing, and the response, then you could read off from this what the quantal response, best response was going to be. In this case, you'll notice what happens is that as long as the behavior temperature is pretty low, it's much the same as the Heaviside function. You have three equilibria. There are three crossings of the 45 degree line. One at a very low level, but not zero. So there's a little bit of Linux use or Windows use even when almost nobody is using Windows. And also up here, but not at one. So there's still a little bit of Linux users even when almost everybody is using Windows. This middle one is unstable because the best response is crossing from below. Now, the high temperature is an interesting example. How many equilibria are there going to be at this high temperature? Just one, right? Because the S-curve doesn't, the S-curve, the strategic complementarity at the interior equilibrium is less than one. The effective beta is less than one. So there's only one crossing here, and it's stable, which tells you that as the behavior temperature changes, you're going to change from a close to monomorphic equilibrium. When the behavior temperature is low, you're going to see almost all Windows or almost all Linux users. But if the behavior temperature is high enough, people just aren't paying attention, or they're distracted, or whatever might be the problem, in fact, you're going to get a quite qualitatively different outcome, namely this polymorphic mixed equilibrium, where half the time people choose one thing, half the time they choose the other thing, and the strategic complementarity doesn't get enough traction. Okay, this is actually the end of this lecture. There's another slide. I wanted to thank some people about all this general stuff, Sam Bowles, particularly Raji Sethi, Mike Piori, and several students, Pedro Cadenas, Ella Scharfenegger, and Gregor Semyonyuk. And then there's some references to work in the literature. But let me, before we stop and take a little break, just see if there's any question about how you put together the entropy constraint and the, Daniel.
If you're using data in a model in this capacity, would it be possible to then sort of tease out the behavior temperature from the data?
I think so, or at least you could say some things about it. For one thing, it's going to make a difference whether you see a polymorphic equilibrium, that is sort of an interior equilibrium where people will do sometimes one thing and sometimes the other, or whether you're seeing close to these extremes. So that right there gives you some information about what's going on. To get the actual shape of this best response is a little trickier, because normally what you see are just the equilibria. I mean, it's, you know, you'd, otherwise you'd have to do some kind of counterfactual, like an experiment or something like that, to try to tease out what people would do if they were not in equilibrium. Yeah. But I think that kind of work is, in many problems in economics and political economy, that kind of work has huge payoffs, has huge payoffs to doing it. Okay, go. Now we're back from break, and Jose thought up a question during the break. So
my question is, how in the social interaction model, when you introduce the entropy constraint problem, I'm not very clear how is it that the Z or the action that is not related to the individual choice is altering or affecting the frequency distribution.
Okay. So the question is that we write the payoff function in this way, U of X and Z. So it's U of a particular action X condition on Z. So the payoff to the typical individual depends on what everybody else is doing. For example, your payoff to having a Linux computer depends on how many of your associates are running the Linux operating system. That's the idea. In general, we just write it symbolically, U of X comma Z, or U of X given conditional on Z. In all of the examples that I do, they're all these quadratic examples with a linear best response. So the examples are all alpha plus beta Z. The best response is alpha plus beta Z. That's true, for example, that's what's behind this. And you get the quadratic because the payoff declines as you go away from the optimum. And the drama here is that when you put this lower bound on, then you no longer get a nice symmetrical probability distribution, but you get this highly skewed probability distribution, which are characteristic of a lot of economic data, especially when there is some kind of a lower bound. One of the cases where you are sure you have a lower bound, well, here, for example, is the alpha plus beta Z best response. One of the examples is that's very, where the lower bound X low and X high are very logical, is when what you're choosing is the frequency with which you do one thing or the other. The frequency with which you're going to do Linux or you're going to buy Windows. Because you know that frequency can't be less than zero. You can't do it less often than never. And it can't be any higher than one. You can't do it more often than all the time. So in that case, X low and X high are very well established. And that's what I was drawing here, where the X low is zero and the X high is one. Does that help? Another person wanted to go over this particular case where instead of an effort function like the quadratic, you actually make the effort function the temperature-weighted entropy. And I find this kind of amusing, but it works fine, and it sometimes may be the simpler model. The reason what it's saying is that the real effort the typical individual has is making a decision at all. And this seems to me to be psychologically very sound. Most people don't like to make decisions. So the maximum entropy is to toss a coin in this case, right? You don't want to look into whether Linux works better than Windows or how many people are using Linux or how many people are using Windows. You just want to toss a coin. What stops you from just tossing the coin is the fact that you do know that your future life is going to be more or less convenient depending on both how well the two operating systems work and how many of your associates are using each operating system. And you don't like it, but it drags you away from the coin tossing towards leaning towards one or the other of the outcomes. And you get this kind of thing. Okay. Now we're going to move into new territory, which maybe is good because so far everything's been rather abstract. I've tried to give you examples so that you got a feel for how you work things out. But now we're really going to get into hardcore political economy, and we're going to look at the some implications of this way of looking at explanation in the social sciences at political economy for classical political economy. And this is probably going to take, and certainly I cannot finish this. This is quite a long lecture today. I doubt that I'll be able to finish all of it next week because there are some fairly subtle things in it that I'm sure we're going to want to discuss in some detail. Let's look at, so we're going to look at classical political economy, and what I mean by classical political economy is primarily Smith and Marx. Ricardo begins his book by saying that he agrees with every single thing that Adam Smith said, except his theory of value, which is like agreeing with everything in the religion except the belief in God or something. But so you have this kind of problem. But I'm not going to focus a lot on Ricardo. There are undoubtedly a lot of applications of these ideas that you could generate in Ricardo if you're interested in that. So I don't want to suggest that there's no point in looking at Ricardo or Malthus. The whole theory of population is very open to this kind of approach. I'm just not going to do that. I'm going to concentrate on the theory of commodity exchange in Smith and Marx. Why is the entropy approach useful? Well, we've seen that the entropy-constrained behavior approach generates endogenous fluctuation. Right? That's what we just saw. You, instead of everything being concentrated in one response, one outcome, the model predicts that you're going to see the identical individuals distributed in some way, or that may turn into you're going to see prices or something distributed over time when you do repeated trials of a certain model. So the entropy approach is key because it generates endogenous fluctuations, and one of the key ideas of the classical political economists was this notion that what you actually see, the market prices, always are fluctuating around centers of gravitation. That means that the entropy-constrained behavior at least gives us the hope of having a more rigorous and formal derivation of the kinds of fluctuations that the classical political economists talk about qualitatively. And we can bring that more into a quantitative. In fact, I'll give you, there's some quite striking examples of that that I'll show you later in the course, especially around the profit rate, the distribution of profit rates, where some work has been done. Actually, as far as I can see, this is a huge open area for research. Nobody knows much about these entropy-constrained models. Nobody's applied them very much empirically. And there are a huge number of relevant questions that you might want to ask of data about these things. The social interaction model is also important because the central problem for the classical political economists was to understand how an economy can spontaneously organize itself, say, through commodity exchange. Well, if you interpret spontaneous as Nash equilibrium, stable Nash equilibrium, then the social interaction model is at least a good candidate as a method to dissect and analyze exactly what is at issue there. And that's what I'm going to spend most this lecture on. So jumping right in, the central figure in Smith's initial discussion of the division of labor, this is chapter one of The Wealth of Nations, and you might as well go back and read the whole first book of The Wealth of Nations. It doesn't take very long to do it. If you want to get up to speed on this, make sure that you know what he says. I think you will read it, even if you've read it before, so many times that you'd never want to read it again. I think as a result of what we've talked about, you'll read it this time with a little different angle and maybe see some different things in it than you saw before. The central figure in Smith's initial discussion, which is quite short, of the division of labor is the concept of an independent producer. And the independent producer is free, at least over some time horizon, which Smith doesn't make very specific, and I'm not going to make very specific, but that's an interesting question, to choose a particular line of production. So the example Smith refers to is the early rude state of society where hunter-gatherers might be producing either hunting deer or hunting beaver, and the deer hunters would trade the deer for beaver with the beaver hunters because they want to consume both of them. In this scenario, there are some basic points just to clear out cobwebs and possible confusion. The typical producer either owns or creates her own means of production. So there's no issue of a capitalist who owns the means of production or the means of production being appropriated as private property. Well, they are private property, but they belong to the independent, to the producer directly. So you want to think, well, if you need to make a bow and arrow to hunt the deer, then part of hunting the deer is you go out and you find the right kind of tree and you make yourself a bow and arrow before you hunt the deer. I mean, that's just part of the process of hunting the deer. And you do not charge yourself interest on the, that's really the main difference here, is that the independent producer doesn't know about compound interest. So the independent producer just counts the labor involved in getting the bow and arrow as exactly the same as the labor involved in finding the deer and killing it. So you don't have any compounding of this kind. Smith argues, and this is a very important passage in Smith, I'll quote it a little later, I have a slide with the whole thing, that the mobility of producers among different lines of production will tend to equalize the advantages and disadvantages of each line of production. And his argument there is quite plausible and very persuasive, and almost nobody has ever really questioned it in this context. The notion is that if one line of production was much more advantageous than another line of production, then the producers, all of whom can do any of the things that can change themselves from deer hunting to beaver hunting or whatever the different lines of production are, will all gravitate towards the most advantageous one. And by crowding that, for example, by producing more deer, they're going to push down the price of deer or something like that, and that will tend to even out the advantages and disadvantages, which is the basic logic behind what is often called the labor theory of value. The advantages of a line of production in a commodity-producing economy where products exchange through money are primarily the money income the production affords the producer. So if the deer and the beaver are commodities, as you go out and you hunt them, and then you exchange them on a monetized market, the main thing you're interested in is how much money do you get for the amount of time and effort that you had to spend. That's the main advantage. The main disadvantage is the time and effort that you have to spend, which roughly speaking, we could call the labor. In a quite broad sense, and you want to really read what Smith has to say. This is quite important because Marx also actually endorses this part of Smith in volume 3 of Capital. He says, Smith has that part correct. And I can find you that example. Looking ahead a little bit, just to try to sweep away a few possible cobwebs, in the later development of this whole line of thinking in Marx, the individual producer is going to become a capitalist firm. And what's important about the capitalist firm is that it has an internal complex relation of production, because it has a capitalist who owns the means of production as private property, and the labor, the direct producers, are wage laborers who are getting paid a wage in exchange for their labor power. But many of the features of commodity production with independent producers also apply to capitalist firms. For example, there's the same, Smith argues, that the same general logic, the capitalist firms will gravitate to those lines of production where the advantages are greatest as they are perceived by the capitalist, since it's the capitalist who runs the thing. That's very similar to the independent producer story. In fact, many of the features of commodity production would apply to economies with enterprises that are organized in other ways. For example, as producer cooperatives, or to worker households who are producing actual commodities, say guild craftsmen who have a workshop. But in order, I just want that in the background of your mind, that this is not just a narrow thing about this fiction of independent producers, but the logic of it actually has further implications beyond that. And here is the key idea that I'm going to put forward, which I call the hub and spoke model. And the idea of the hub and spoke model is to focus our attention on a well-defined model that we can actually work through logically that has the key features of this division of labor argument of Smith's. So we have an economy made up of a fairly large number, which we'll call capital N, of identical independent producers. So all of these producers are interchangeable. And in particular, it means that any of them can do any of the specializations that are eventually going to take place, or they can diversify their production in a self-sufficient way. So they're all identical in that way. The producers require, let's say, K different products as inputs to production and as consumption. So we have K different use values in Marx's language. These are the actual products, and they're characterized by what kind of food it is, or what kind of clothing it is, or what kind of tool it is, or whatever it might be that makes it a use value. To make things as simple as possible, assume that the producers require the products in strict proportions. Now, this goes against all of marginalist revolution, because the whole marginalist revolution was about that prices were going to be equal to marginal utilities. But I'm saying they're strict complements. So there aren't any marginal utilities, right? You either have the things in the right proportion. If you have one a little bit more than in those proportions, its marginal utility is zero. If you have it in a little less than that proportion, its marginal utility is infinite. So we're definitely leaving behind the world of marginalism. I'd like to emphasize that you don't have to make this assumption. It makes it specific and easier for us to work through what the payoffs are going to be to various counterfactual circumstances. And if somebody wants to write a paper about what happens if you relax this assumption in the hub and spoke model, that would be a terrific paper. if you want to introduce a less strict assumption. So we basically have Leontief utility as the payoffs. The payoff to a typical producer who winds up with a bundle X1 of good 1, X2, and so forth, and X should be XK, is just the minimum of them. So we're going to measure, we're going to arrange things so that we measure the quantities of each of the produced goods in exactly the quantity that they go into this bundle, which is without loss of generality. Each of these products is a good, or in Smith's terms, a use value. So that's the basic idea here. All of the independent producers have access to the same technology of production, which consists of two alternatives. First of all, the producer could diversify, that is, be self-sufficient, and just produce by herself. Produce all of the different products by herself. And in that case, she can produce the output bundle 1111. She can produce one unit of each of these use values. That's the subsistence farm, the self-sufficient subsistence farm. Or the producer can specialize in the production of one of the goods. She has to choose one. K goes from 1 to capital K. In which case she produces an amount A, which is quite a lot bigger than 2 times K. And you'll see why that's an important number. A is significantly larger than 2K units of that particular good. There's no effort here. There's no marginal cost. There's no, she just, if she specializes, she puts some effort into it and she gets that output. There's no production function relating the amount of labor she puts in. She just has to put in some labor and she gets that output. But specialization requires effort, which the typical individual views as equivalent to the payoff from diversification. That is one unit. Okay. Does everybody see this scenario? So you can go back to the family farm and you produce your milk and your clothes and your and keep the farmhouse roof going and all that. And when you do that, you get a payoff of one, because that's how we're measuring things. Or you specialize, in which case you pay to specialize each time you produce just one effective unit of effort, and then you have to put the effort in and you produce A units of the output. I call this the hub and spoke model to try to leverage on the image that the hub is diversification. That's where everybody does everything, is self-sufficient, but it has very low productivity. The spokes are the individual lines of specialization. So here's a little picture of it. Here's the hub. In the hub, you diversify, or you go out to one spoke. You specialize in producing food, or healthcare, or education, or transportation, or clothing, or whatever it might be. And you could imagine many, many spokes from a hub, depending on how complex production is in a society. Now, what's the social coordination problem in the hub and spoke model? I'm hoping it's pretty transparent and that you can already see the point of it. I mean, that's why you want to have a really simple model, is so that everybody can see the point. Here's the point. If the K producers specialize and share their outputs equally, what will they get? Well, each of them is producing A, but they have to divide it up with the other K producers. So when they divide it up, if they divide it up equally, they each get A over K. So A over K times 1 times 1 times 1. So their payoff is going to be A over K, but they have to pay this one unit of effort cost to specialize, right? And that's why we want A to be bigger than 2 times K, because we want A over K to be bigger than 2. So that there's a definite advantage in principle to specialization. Given that assumption, the division of labor results in a significantly higher payoff from the bundle of products for each producer, allowing for the effort cost of specialization, than does diversification. Now, this is as simple as I can make it, or was as simple as I've been able to make it yet. Maybe it can be made simpler, and there's some, we'll see that there's some peculiar features of this model which maybe could be smoothed out. And if you have some good ideas about smoothing it out, that would be a great thing to write a paper about. But let's just follow this basic path for a while. So it would be advantageous to each independent producer to engage in specialized production and share the resulting collective product. The social coordination outcome locates the producers at the spokes. So if we're doing social coordination, we all divide up according to some plan or other, and we produce more and we get a higher payoff. Each of us gets a higher payoff. A technical point is that it's very convenient then to presume that there's N is a multiple, as an integer multiple of K. So we can put the same number of producers at each spoke. Right? So you essentially have N copies of this K group of producers that you're sorting out. Okay. And the payoff is A over K minus 1. Why minus 1? Because that's the effort cost you have to pay to specialize. And you want that to be bigger than 1, which is the payoff to diversify in order for the social coordination problem to be. If this didn't hold, there's no social coordination problem because everybody would be Robinson Crusoe and everybody would diversify and you would be back in the ordinary micro textbook. There are many equivalent social coordination outcomes. In a sense, because we can put any one of these producers at any one of the spokes, because they're all interchangeable. So if we think of an outcome as being a specific assignment of specific producers to specific spokes, there's a whole lot of them. But they're really all the same, as long as you put the same number at each spoke, because you get the same payoff and you get the same advantage of specialization. You could imagine that this kind of social coordination outcome might be achievable in small communities through direct negotiation or enforcement of some kind of community norms. Or somebody suggested that this might have something to do with caste societies, which I have not actually thought about, where very strong traditions assign a division of labor, or a certain primitive division of labor, to different attributive outcomes. Does anybody have any question about the hub and spoke model? Yes, it's Justin. Here, wait until you get.
It seems that this model could apply to our society, but the only aspect that I'm skeptical about is the way in which A, it has to be greater than 2K, and thus the output from specialization has to be dependent upon the total number of goods being produced. So that would be saying, like, someone who majors in economics, their output has to be greater than, say, the total number of departments. And I'm not sure why A and K have an intrinsic relation.
Okay. Justin asks, why? What about this condition A over K has to be greater than 2? He's saying, well, maybe that's a little inflexible because you could get significant advantages from specialization even if they didn't scale with the number of different use values. I think it would be the way I would rephrase that. And I would say, sure, That's right. That's an artifact, actually, of the payoff function that I've assumed, the Leontief complement payoff function that I've assumed for the typical agent. If there was more substitutability among the goods in the payoff, in the agent's payoff function, then you could relax this assumption quite a lot. Esben, and then Andrei.
It kind of goes back to your the early definitions of things on slide 4. You talked you talked about Adam Smith's deer and beaver, and then we went into a capitalist economy where people were paid. The main advantages were money, and then the disadvantages were labor. And I'm just curious to like think about, or if you could say a little bit more about that definition of disadvantages in relation to what is labor. Is it only labor aimed at commodity production, or what is that? When is what I do labor, and when is what I do disadvantage? When there's something there that's kind of
okay. Esben wants to go back and to this brief look ahead, which is always a dangerous pedagogical thing to do because then you have to explain more, and particularly wants to ask what is this idea that what's in a monetary exchange economy, which we haven't even gotten up to. We haven't even really introduced money, but I'll answer the question. That what the individual producer is probably looking at is the balance between how much time and trouble it is to produce whatever it is, deer or beaver or clothing, and the money that you get from selling it. Okay. Well, first of all, there is a surplus here, clearly, right? There's a big surplus if A over K is greater, is at least as big as 2. And you can see that surplus in the increase in the payoff of the individual agent when everybody shares out and does specialization and shares out. In a capitalist society, the capitalists are going to appropriate a good deal of that surplus. That's what Marx is about. But I'm going to have a whole lecture on Marx, just for Marx, and I'd really rather put that question off until we get to that point. What I just wanted to emphasize here is what Justin said, which is to try to suggest that this isn't such a bad model of our actual society in a very abstract and stripped down way. Because what's basically going on is you're trading effort for money. You're going to be trading effort for money, which is what most people do in our society. You want to give it back to Advait? Yeah.
Yeah, Professor, my question is regarding the last thing, the last comment that you just made about you said it can be used, the hub and spoke model can be used maybe if there were individual Robinson Crusoes at each spoke, or if in a small society you could through negotiation have a person specializing in something. But when you spoke about the caste system, now I just want to ask about the assumption that producers are identical and interchangeable, and how, on what grounds are they actually identical, so that we can use the model or we can eliminate difference abstract in a sensible manner and eliminate the right things to make them actually interchangeable at each end of the spoke.
Okay, Abed asks about the interchangeability of the producers and exactly what is involved in that assumption, and what's the connection of that to the caste, my offhand remark about caste production. The interchangeability of the producer seems to me just bedrock for Smith. Now, you can read Smith yourself, but he spends quite a bit of time, for example, explaining why there isn't as much difference between the professor at the university and the porter, the person who opens and closes the door, as there might seem to be when you see them in their full maturity, because as kids they played together and could have been interchanged in one way or another. So I think that the real motivation there is the classical political economy view of interchangeability. And the relevant dimension of interchangeability is that anybody, at least at some point in their life cycle, could have done any of these things. I would say that's really the bottom line. And that really calls into question the caste. Okay, well, then let me say, the social coordination outcome might be achievable in small communities through direct negotiation and enforcement by community norms. But that does not put Robinson Crusoe at each spoke, because Robinson Crusoe is diversifier. He has nobody else with which to do a division of labor. Now, if he goes and becomes a clothing producer or a blacksmith or a cobbler or something like that, he's no longer Robinson Crusoe, because he's only producing one thing. He's not producing everything. And the suggestion here in small communities that you might get a degree of division of labor stabilized. The next question I'm going to ask is what game actually supports this division of labor as an equilibrium? And I was just suggesting, well, in a small community, you could imagine that maybe social norms or traditions or practice or something could support it at a small scale. But it's clearly not, as Justin points out, going to support it at the scale of the world economy or of the American economy. You're going to have something else going there. Does that help? Now, the caste thing, I really almost wish I hadn't said. I'm just throwing it out, and it may be a complete red herring, because the caste systems are not systems of interchangeability in any practical, because you have these very strong attributive elements that sort of doom people to some fate or other. You gotta get the mic again. Yeah.
That's the thing about calling it a caste system, is it's developed now to mean that being a professor is better than being a porter, or being a blacksmith is worse than being something else. When it actually wasn't the initial, when it started out, it was something like this, just a negotiation of you do what's good for you and your father teaches it to you, and then, you do that. But that's why, and then it, maybe they would have been interchangeable at the get-go, but once it developed, once these norms became something else, that's when this kind of interchangeability or the caste system where one caste is better than another manifests.
Well, the reason I was just suggesting it, because I think some people are interested in caste systems, and it's the hub and spoke model. You could try to think through what caste looks like in terms of the hub and spoke model. But the difference is that for Smith, the porter could have become a professor, the professor could have become a porter. In a caste system, that's not true. The porter is part of the porter caste, and the professor is part of the professor caste, and they can't be interchanged. One curious effect, though, of the caste system, we normally think of the caste system that there are certain high castes that have high return occupations and certain low castes that have low return occupations. But it's clear from this point of view that that might invert. You might get a situation where, in fact, the low caste use value becomes scarcer. You know, and there are things like that you might want to look into, either historically or theoretically. Any other hub and spoke? Because this hub and spoke is just bedrock. So, Oreo, here is get the.
Actually, I wanted to discuss a similar thing, but on the idea of mobility and equalization of labor, because yesterday, for example, Professor Nell mentioned exactly the opposite, that it's heterogeneity of labor is super crucial. To what extent we can think that this division of labor is a process that develops in time, but Adam Smith is identifying a long-term trend, and that we can assume as if that labor is homogeneous.
Okay. Oriol refers to a talk that many of us were at yesterday from Professor Emeritus Ed Nell here, which actually touched on exactly this question. That is, what's the way you think about the division of labor and the sources of the division of labor? And I thought it was a wonderful talk to focus attention on exactly these things. But the point of view that I'm taking is really quite different from Nell's. But I think it's more faithful to Adam Smith. Now, you can read Adam Smith and decide that for yourselves. But my point of view is that there is a stage where the labor is undifferentiated. It's like stem cells. Okay, the stem cell can turn into any kind of cell, right? In the same way, the boys playing in the schoolyard can turn either into porters or professors or blacksmiths or cobblers or whatever it might be. Once the stem cell differentiates and actually commits itself to being a blood cell or a bone cell or a neuron, then it can't go backwards very easily, which I think is also true of the division of labor. And but I think it's very important from this classical political economy point of view to realize that for Adam Smith there was this potential to become anything. And I think that's very important. I think that's what Marx means by universal labor. That's the universal stage of labor. It's the stage, and it's extremely important, as we'll see in just a moment, because it structures the whole question of the independent producer choosing which line of production to specialize in, which if you're going to have a decentralized support of the division of labor, you have to have some theory of how that happens, and preferably a Nash equilibrium theory, or an equilibrium theory of how that happens. Well, maybe I'll push on a little bit here so we can see at least some of the beginnings. Now, there's actually a number of layers of this. And let me try to tell you the layers so that you don't get too confused. The first layer is to use the social interaction model to think about the choice between specializing and diversifying. That is very much like the Linux Windows or assurance game kind of problem. And I just want to develop that at some length. If you get diversification, so you go, I mean, if you get specialization, so you go to the equilibrium where everybody specializes. Then there's the question of how you support specialization through exchange. And we're going to talk a little bit about barter versus monetary exchange, which is another level at which the social interaction model, I think, can throw some light. I'm going to argue that there is a stable monetary exchange equilibrium and that barter exchange is unstable, and I'll try to explain that. Then once you get the money issue settled, then there's the question of how do you support the correct allocation of the producers to the different spokes, which I think is what Oriol is particularly interested in, and that's clearly a game kind of a problem. Which is actually the labor theory of value, which is going to turn out to be the labor theory of value. And then there's the question, which is the most interesting question, can you support the social coordination equilibrium as a Nash equilibrium in this setting? And I believe the answer to that is no, and I'm going to explain to you that you cannot, and that the Nash equilibrium is not socially coordinated, although it does sustain some elements of the division of labor. So that's the sort of broader agenda, but we're not going to be able to do all of that in this afternoon or even probably through next week. But let's get started. So we can apply the social interaction model to the hub and spoke system. First of all, by thinking about the typical individual producer trying to decide whether to specialize as part of a team or to diversify and be self-sufficient. And this is actually, from Justin's point of view, I mean, this is not an irrelevant choice. There's still a lot of people who basically are producing in a self-sufficient way in the world. and are not everybody is part of the whole global division of labor by any means. So let's suppose that a typical producer has a frequency P of choosing specialization, and that that's conditional on the proportion of other producers, P bar, who are specializing. Okay. And the 1 minus P bar, I think there's a bar missing from that P, are going to be diversifiers. So those are the two choices. The division of labor has the effect of dividing the typical producer. I think this is extremely important from Justin's point of view, because this is where I think we live. The typical producer gets divided up into K separate individuals who are each making separate decisions. And that's where the social coordination problem comes from. Robinson Crusoe is just one guy on his island doing diversified production. So he doesn't have any big social coordination problem. But once he gets exploded into these K spokes of the wheel, then all of a sudden there you are out on your spoke. You might want all the folks on the other spokes to do something, but how are you going to get them to do it? You don't have any way to do it. Unless you have socialism or some political process or something like that. But you don't have any way through your individual action to determine what all the other individual producers are going to do. The big question is, can the socially coordinated division of labor be sustained as the equilibrium of a social interaction model? I'm going to argue no, it cannot, but that's turns out to be a much more difficult argument than I thought it was going to be. I thought it would just fall right out, but so much for things falling right out. Well, let's think, in order to fix our ideas, let's think about a simple scheme of specialization, which I'll call a spontaneous production system, two-part spontaneous production system. Here's how the spontaneous production system is supposed to work. The first part of the spontaneous organization system instructs the producers to line up in some random order. So you see, every time we do this, we're compressing all the life cycle and all that stuff into repeated plays of this game, right? Because we have no, every time you start a new week or something, you can go back to the hub and go out to the spokes in different ways. So we're just thinking of it that way. So you line up in some random order, and then each go in turn to find the subset of lines of production, the spokes, that are already occupied by the smallest number of producers. Choose one from this subset at random with equal probabilities and specialize in its production. Now that's a decentralized algorithm, right? You can do that with the information that's available to each individual. What's going to happen then is that the first producer to choose will find all the spokes empty, right? And therefore will choose one at random. Then successive producers will fill up the remaining spokes, first putting one on each spoke, and then after there's one on each spoke, the next one will be the second, and so forth, and they'll keep doing that. And the fact that there's an even multiple of the spokes in number of producers is an even multiple of the number of spokes, assures that in this kind of musical chairs game, every producer is going to land on one spoke, and you'll have an equal number of producers on each spoke. The second part instructs each producer to specialize. Now comes the key point, and deliver her output unconditionally in equal proportions to all N producers, including herself. So this is not exchange, it's not barter, it's gift. Okay, you go to your spoke, you produce your shoes or your clothing or your houses, and you give, you divide up whatever you've produced unconditionally among everybody who's in the system. Now, the reason for thinking about this, aside from the fact that it helps us to understand sort of what goes wrong and what the real problem of political economy is that it seems like a possible way to get something like the social coordination solution. In fact, you'd get exactly the social coordination solution if this worked, because what's going to happen is each product, will, how many units will be produced, it's A times N over K, right? Because you got the N producers at each, the little lowercase n producers at each spoke, and they each produce A. And on average, each producer then is going to receive A over K units of the products, of all of the products, and has to pay the effort price of minus one to specialize, but that means her payoff is A over K minus one. Well, that's exactly the social coordination payoff. So if you could make this work, it would be, if this were an equilibrium, if this were a Nash equilibrium, it would allow you to achieve the social coordination division of labor in a decentralized way. So you might think of the spontaneous production system, and I urge you to ponder it a little bit, because I think it's behind a lot of discussion of socialism and sort of people's general idea of why things are screwed up in modern society, that it should be more like this, should be more like this. For one thing, everybody gets the same under this, so there's no inequality, right? And everything looks in that sense, rather rational. Okay, so you could think of this as a kind of spontaneous socialism in which every producer acts rationally in the interests of the whole society. But is this, in fact, an equilibrium? Well, now comes an important methodological point. How do we decide whether this is an equilibrium? We have to decide whether, if everybody else does this, right, is it the best response of the typical producer to do the same thing? If the answer to that question is yes, then we could really close up shop and go home, because we would have solved the social coordination problem for the division of labor, which would be a good day's work for a political economy class, and we could. But fortunately, or unfortunately, depending on whether you look at it from the point of view of education or actual social life, it turns out that the spontaneous organization is not an equilibrium, because the best response to it of an individual, typical individual, is to diversify, not to participate in the specialization and the division of labor. Now let me just walk through that, and we'll come back to this point next week, because we're almost at the end of our time. We can introduce the general idea. So the typical producer's payoff following the spontaneous organization strategy we've just seen is A over K minus 1. Notice that you have to be able to calculate these things. I mean, you can't, it's not hand-waving. It's because we've made these specific assumptions that I can say exactly what that payoff is. Now, what is the typical producer's payoff to diversifying, assuming that she would have produced in the first sector if she had specialized? Well, you can count it up. And here's what's going to happen. She's going to get her equal share of everybody else's production, right? Because the assumption is that everybody else is doing the spontaneous organization strategy. So she's going to get that. She's going to be a little short because she isn't specializing. Okay. So in particular, if she was supposed to specialize in the first sector, there's not quite enough of the first sector use value to go around, because she herself is not producing her fair share of it, is why that happens. Now, next week when I have a little more time, we'll go through this calculation, but it turns out that the payoff to diversifying, and when everybody else specializes, is actually 3 minus 2 over n, which as long as there's more than two people, which is what we need to avoid Robinson Crusoe, that's greater than 1. Okay, so it turns out that, in fact, if everybody else did this spontaneous sharing thing, it is to the private and individual advantage of a typical producer to free ride by not specializing, instead diversifying and collecting her share of the social output. Now you could say to yourself, well, that means there couldn't possibly be any social surplus for her to collect. That's right, but look exactly at how the logic of this works in the social interaction model. The question is conditional. If everybody else did it, what would be your best response? And if the answer is it would be to do the same thing, then you have an equilibrium. If the answer is it's to do something different, then you don't have an equilibrium. And in this case, you don't have an equilibrium. So the spontaneous organization sharing socialism cannot be sustained as an equilibrium, at least according to this type of argument. Now, maybe somebody can see a way to get around this. I'll tell you one way that you could sort of get around it, which is in Bowles's book. Bowles makes the point that in these social interaction models, if your payoff, if the individual's payoff is not just her individual payoff, but it's a weighted average of her individual payoff and the social pay, everybody else's payoff, then if she puts a high enough weight on everybody else's payoff, it will sustain itself as an equilibrium. And you can try to think a little bit about the implications of that. Justin, if we can get a mic, and then we're just probably going to have time for one.
I just want to follow up on that point in terms of, it seems that specialization, the output of specialization, is actually dependent on the hub. So the use value is no.
Okay. Well, go ahead and finish.
Just going back to the assumption of, sort of A being greater than 2K, there is this dependence between the hub, that being the number of and the output of the given of a single specialization.
Well, there's a param. Okay, so Justin says, isn't there a dependence of the spokes on the hub? In the parameters, yes, because in order to set it up so that the social coordination solution is specialization, you have to have a big enough surplus from specialization to pay for the effort of specializing. So that's true. But if we don't have that, then there's nothing to argue about. There's no point in participating in the division of labor if you don't do better than you could do on the family farm, right? On the self-sufficient family farm. Dynamically, though, there's no dependence of the production in the spokes on what happens in the hub. If you go to the spoke, you produce A units. And it doesn't really matter how many other people go to the spokes or whether a whole lot of people are in the hub. If you do it, that's what you're going to produce. So there's no dependence in that sense. Okay, I think we have reached the witching hour here. So we'll pick up here next week.